really delighted to be doing this. I've admired Deepa Dhanraj's work for several years. Besides, she's a friend and fellow traveler in the women's movement. I've used her films in my classroom, so it gives me great pleasure to be talking about it with fellow feminists and others. So what we're going to do before we get into conversation is to see a set of clips from her films over a period of time. Deepa's been making films for nearly 40 years, so we felt we must see a little bit of that film world she's created, which is very rich, layered. So here we're going to be showing clips from about 5 films. The oldest is Tambaku Chakula Ubali, made in 1981. This focuses on the tobacco workers of Nipani, who amidst great odds formed a women's trade union. Following that is a clip from Deepa's iconic film made a decade after that, Something Like a War, on the government of India's ignominious family planning policy. And then a film that she made in the following decade on the Tamil Nadu Muslim Women's Jabat called Invoking Justice. Deepa's films have not just looked at women's movements or concerns that we address as feminists, but she's also been very interested in critical pedagogy. So after this, we have a clip from her film, a set of 9 films called Young Historians, which look at how children may be educated to do history. And this is set in this is from Northern Karnataka, the Gadag district. And then we have clips from her latest film, We Did Not Come Here to Die, which looks at the momentous events of 2016, following the institutional murder of Rohit Vemmula, the UNA struggle, the struggles of students in various universities. And we end with a clip from a very unusual film, The Advocate, which takes a very, very meditative look at the life and times of the legendary K.G. Kannabiran, civil rights activist, thinker, writer, but also walks us through a feminist vision of left struggles and the civil rights movement. So without much ado, I will request PLD to start showing us the film clips.
एकदिवशी असं कुरबिड्याच्या वकारीत 5 मिनिटं टाइम झाला म्हणून मालकाने दरवाजा बंद केला आणि सगळ्या बाहेर बाहेर हात केल्या आणि खेड्याच्या बायका आत होत्या. बाहेरच्या बायका दिवाणजीला मालकाला अन्ना घ्या, संध्याकाळी 10 मिनिटं टाइम करून सुट्टी करा म्हणून दरवाज्याला उभा राहून सांगत होत्या. तर मालक बोंब मारत जाऊन द्या असं म्हणून मालक गेला. मग बाहेरच्या बायका दिवाणजीने असं म्हटल्या की खेड्याच्या बायका बाहेर काढा. त्या बी बायका बाहेर आल्या, ह्या बायका मिळून दरवाज्याला बसल्या. निपाणीत एखादी आग लागते असं सगळीकडे दणदणलं. सुट्टी झाल्यावर आम्ही तिथनं या लागलो. त्या बायका दरवाज्याला बसल्या. त्या बायका समोर आम्ही उभा राहिलो. त्या बायका म्हणाल्या, बघा बायानो, तुमची बी परिस्थिती तीच आहे आणि आमची बी परिस्थिती तीच आहे. मालक किती छावतोय ते तुम्ही आम्ही एक गुण घ्याल, काय तर करूया. आम्ही घरला जाताना विचार करत गेलो आणि म्हटलं त्या बायका बोलत्या तेच खरं आहे. परत दुसऱ्या दिवशी सकाळी लवकर उठून येऊन बघतो तर त्या बायका त्या दरवाज्याला बसलेल्याच होत्या. सुभाष जोशी नावाचा एक बिडी फॅक्टरीच खुडारी म्हणून काम करणारा तो तिथं आला होता. त्यानं सांगितलं की निप्पाणीतल्या 60-70 वकारी बंद करून मोर्चा काढून कुरबिट्याच्या अड्ड्यात हजर व्हा. मोर्चा काढून 8-9 हजार बायका होत्या.
घ्यायला पाहिजे बायकांचं मिटिंग. वकारबंदी केली म्हणजे एक झुटून बायका सगळ्या कुरबिट्याच्या अड्ड्यात आल्या तर बरं आहे. ऑपरेशन कराबान तो पहली मोटी आर्क नहीं आ रही है, तो पटवारी भी आ रही है, गरदाऊर भी आ रही है, सरपंच ही आ रही है, कोई नौकरी गम कोई लगा भी देवे कोई ना तो वो भी आ रही है कि भाई तनतन कान का नहीं पहले केस लिया तो बे आदमी आवे और तो बटे कौन आवे दूसरा तो कोई आ रही तो मोटे आर कह लुग न भाई अपन ओ दे रिया अपन को खुदा बन जमियालान तो कह तार को खुदा दे वहाँ कोई कहे जमीन कोने जी ने कह दी भाई तन जमीन दे दिए वहाँ कोई ने कह देवे कि हेज को नहीं भाई तन लोन दरा दे वहाँ तार झट पास नहीं वे रही तो मैं पास करा दे वहाँ सरपंच यान बोल रही है
और तो ना सब बात को मालूम रहे भाई हाँ इम फायदो मिल रही हो चाहे दे रही हो चाहे सरकार पर औरतान वो फायदो औरतान तक पूछ भाई कौन दे भी फायदा
हाँ बाकी वे कि भाई मुनी जाओ काम तो मने हारो घर में करना पड़े तो कह रही है कि तू क्यों नहीं जावे तू जा तन कहीं दुख वे रही है तो मुँह मारा मन में कह रही हूँ कि मोटिया ना कहीं दुख वे रही हो ईशो जो को वो दबाव लगा रही हो कि भाई तू जा तू जा तू जा
कुमार
तो मुँह गालू तने किसो दुख वे रही
है सरकार खा बन मिल जाए बीच बीच में जब वो क्यों कर लो मोटियार
जो केस ले जाते हैं उनको भी तो देते हैं ना कि पांच केस पर इतना आपको कुछ मिलेगा या टेलीविजन या कुछ अलग अलग आइटम कर देते हैं उनके लिए तो उनको भी पांच केस पर सात केस पर उनको भी तो मिलता है
குளைனா குளைதான் செட்டப்படி அதுக்கு என்ன நடவடிக்கை பண்ணுமோ பண்ணிக்கங்க அவனை உள்ள வைக்கணுமா அந்த குடும்பத்தை தள்ளிட்டு போணுமா யாரை என்ன பண்ணுமோ பண்ணிக்கங்க
அநீதிக்கு வந்து தலையிட
கண்ணால பார்க்கல அல்லாஹ்வுக்கு தெரிஞ்ச விஷயம் கண்ணால யாரும் பார்க்கல
இந்த தருக்கு வீடு சரி
நீங்க சொல்றீங்க பாருங்க சார் போலீஸ் தான் சொன்னா தான் நான் செய்யணும் ஆதாரம் இதெல்லாம் தேவை ஐ விட்னஸ்லாம் தேவை இந்த ஜமாத்துக்கு அதெல்லாம் தேவை இல்ல ஜமாத்துங்கிறது ஒரு அமைப்புங்கிறது ஒரு மனசாட்சியோட பேசக்கூடிய இதுதான் ஏன்னா அது வந்து போலீஸ் கிடையாது நீங்க வந்து கண்ணால பார்க்கல கண்ணால பார்க்கலங்கிறது இதே நீங்க பேசிட்டு இருக்கீங்க
பையனையோ அல்ல அந்த அம்மாவையோ
அது வந்து உங்களை நீங்களே மறசிட்டீங்க உங்க பொய்யை வந்து உங்களுக்கு தெரிஞ்சு
தெரியாலே தெரிஞ்சா தான் நாங்க சொல்லலாம்
பொண்ணு மேல உங்களுக்கு மரியாதை இருந்துச்சுனா அந்த பொண்ணோட சாவுக்கு நீங்க பதில் சொல்லுங்க வேற ஒண்ணும் சொல்ல வேண்டாம் உங்களுக்கு எல்லாம் தெரியும் ஏ டு இசட் தெரிஞ்சு நீ அவன் கொலை பண்ணலை அவன் கொலைக்கு காரணமே இல்லைன்னு சொல்லி நான் அப்புறம் நம்மளுக்கு கோவம் தானே வரும் இதை சாதாரணமாக ஒரு பெண்ணிட்ட வந்து போய் நீங்கள் போய் ரோட்டில் போய் நின்று மைக்கை கொடுத்து பேட்டி எடுத்தீங்கன்னா இந்த ஊரில் எப்படிமா நடக்குது ஜமாத்துனா கட்ட பஞ்சாயத்து நடக்குதுன்னு சொல்லுவாங்க கட்ட பஞ்சாயத்து தான் நடக்குது எல்லாத்துக்குமே இது தெரியும் ஏன்னா நான் வந்து அனுபவமே பட்டிருக்கேன் வந்து நம்ம ஊரில் பேசும்போது ஒரு குடும்பத்து பிரச்சனை போய் அங்கே உட்காந்து பேசும்போது கட்ட பஞ்சாயத்து மாதிரி பண்ணிவிட்டு பிரச்சனை பண்ணிட்டு மேலே போனால் அடித்தடியும் நடக்கும் அந்த இடத்துல ஒன்றும் அமைதியான முறையில் சமத்து நடக்காது சமத்துல எதிர்பார்ட்டிக்கு அவனுங்களுக்குமே ஆம்பளைக்குள்ளே சண்டை வந்துடும் சண்டை வந்து ஆண்டி ஆண்டி இது பேச்சு மோசமான பேச்செல்லாம் கூட பள்ளிவாசலும் கூட இல்லாமல் பேசிக்கோனுங்க நாரி போயிடும் பிரச்சனை என்ன ஒன்று அது அதர் கேஸ்ட்டு உள்ளே வரமாட்டானுங்க அடிச்சுக்கிட்டாலும் இவனோட அடிச்சுக்குவானுங்க அன்னைக்கு பேசிட்டாலும் இவனோட பேசிக்குவானுங்க பஞ்சாயத்து பண்ணாலும் இவனோட சேர்த்து வச்சாலும் இவனோட இவனுக்குள்ளே முடிச்சுக்கிறதுனால அது இவங்களுக்கு வந்து ஒரு கௌரவமாக இருக்குது என்ன செய்கிறாங்கன்னா அந்த கட்ட பஞ்சாயத்தை அந்த மஸ்ஜித்துக்கு உள்ளே வச்சு செய்கிறாங்க இது இஸ்லாம்ங்கிறாங்க அவ்வளோதான்
ಹಸು ಅವ್ರನ್ನ ಕೀಡ್ ಜಾತರ್ನ ಎಲ್ಲ ಅವನ್ ಮಾಡಿದ್ನಲ್ಲ ಊರಿನ ಜನರು ಎಲ್ಲ ಜನರನ್ನು ಮತ್ತೆ ಬಸವಣ್ಣ ಓಡಿಸಿದ್ರು
ಇಲ್ಲ ಬಹಳಷ್ಟು ಜನ ಒಪ್ಪಲೇ ಇಲ್ಲ ಬಸವ ಮಾಡಿದ್ದು ಒಪ್ಪಲಿಲ್ಲ ಈಗ ನೀವೆಲ್ಲ ಶಾಲೆ ಒಳಗೆ ನಾವೆಲ್ಲ ಅಷ್ಟರು ಕೂಡ ಇರ್ತೀವಿ, ಎಲ್ಲ ಆಟ ಆಡ್ತೀವಿ, ಎಲ್ಲ ಮಾಡ್ತೀವಿ. ನಿಮ್ಮ ಅಪ್ಪ ಅಮ್ಮ ಈಗ ನೀವು ಹಿಂಗೆ ಮನೆಯೊಳಗೆ ಮಾಡಿದ್ರೆ
ಮುಟ್ಕೊಂತೀರಿ, ಮುಟ್ಕೊಂಡೆಲ್ಲ ಆಡ್ತೀರಿ, ಆಡ್ಕೊಂಡು ನಾವು ಹಂಗ ಒಳಗೆ ಹೋಗ್ಬಿಡ್ತೀರಿ, ಮತ್ತ ಅವಾಗ ಹಾವು ಚೋಳು ಏನು ಬರೋದಿಲ್ಲ ಅನ್ರಿ.
ನಮ್ಮ ಮನೆ ತಕ್ಕೈತೆ ಅದು, ಒಂದು ಕಪ್ ಬೇರೆ ಇಟ್ಟಿರ್ತಾರ್ರಿ, ಒಂದು ಮೂರು ಪ್ಲೇಟ್ ಬೇರೆ ಇಟ್ಟಿರ್ತಾರೆ.
ಶಮ್ಮಕ್ರ ಮನೆ ಮಾಡಾರ್ರಿ,
ಅವ್ರ ಹೊಲಾರ್ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ರಿ. ಲೋಟ ಬೇರೆ ಇಟ್ಟಿರ್ತಾರ್ರಿ, ಆ ಉಪ್ಪಿಟ್ಟು ತಿನ್ನದ್ರಿ, ಆ ಪ್ಲೇಟ್ ಏನು ಇಟ್ಟಿರ್ದಿಲ್ರಿ, ಹಳಾಗ ಹಾಕಿ ಕೊಡ್ತಾರ್ರಿ.
ಇದ್ರಲ್ಲಿ ಬಾವಿ ಕಟ್ಟಿ ಮ್ಯಾಗ್ರಿ ಹತ್ತಿಸ್ಕೊಡೋದಿಲ್ರಿ ಹೊಲಾರ್ನ.
ಏ ಬಾವಿ ಕಟ್ಟಿ ಮೇಲೆ ಹಾಕ್ಬಿಡ ರೀ.
ಬಾಂಗ್ಲಾದಾಗ ಹೊಲಾರ್ ಬಾವಿ ಅಂತ ಐತಲ್ರಿ, ಅಲ್ಲೇ ಹೊಲಾರ್ ಬಾವಿ ಅಂತಂದ್ರ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಆದ್ರ ಹೊಲಾರ್ನು ಜಗ್ತಾರ್ರಿ, ಎಲ್ಲಾರು
ಎಲ್ಲರೂ ಜಗ್ತಾರ್ರಿ.
ಆದ್ರ ಬಾಂಗ್ಲಾ ಬಾಯಾಗ ಹೊಲಾರ್ ಜಗ್ಗುದಿಲ್ರಿ, ಮತ್ತ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಐದಾರು ಬಾವಿ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಯಾರು ಬಾವಿ ಕಟ್ಟಿನ ಹತ್ತಿಸ್ಕೊಡೋದಿಲ್ರಿ, ತೆಳಕುಂತಿರ್ತಾರೆ.
ಇವ್ರು ಅವ್ರ ಬಾವಿ ಕಟ್ಟಿ ಹೋದ್ನಾರಿ, ಏ ಅಲ್ಲೇ ನಿಂದ್ರ ಅಲ್ಲೇ ನಿಂದ್ರ ಅಂದ್ರ ಅವ್ರ ಒಬ್ಬ ಬರೋಜರ್ ಯಾಕ್ರಿ ಇದನ್ನ ನಮ್ಗ ನಿಮ್ಗೆ ತೊಡರಿ ಯಾಕ್ರಿ ಅಂತ ಅಂದ್ಯಾರಿ. ಅಲ್ಲೇ ನಿಂತು ಹೋಗಿ ಅದನ್ನ ಗಣಪತಿ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಇಲ್ರಿ ನಾ ಮ್ಯಾಗ ಹತ್ತಿ ಹೋಗ್ಯಾವ ನೋಡ್ರಿ ಅಂತಂದು ಮ್ಯಾಗ ಹತ್ತಿ ಹೋಗ್ರಿ.
ಬಸವ ಮತ್ತು ಎಲ್ಲ ಜನರು ಯಾವ್ದು ಅಸಮಾನತೆ ವಿರುದ್ಧ ಏನ್ ಚಳವಳಿ ಮಾಡಿದ್ರು, ಯಾವ ಅಸ್ಪೃಶ್ಯತೆಯ ವಿರುದ್ಧ ಚಳವಳಿ ಮಾಡಿದ್ರು,
ದೊಡ್ಡವರು ಸಣ್ಣದಿಂದ ಅಶ್ವದಯಿಂದ ಚಳವಳಿ
ಮಾಡಿದ್ರಲ್ಲ, ಆವಾಗನಿಂದ ಇಷ್ಟು ವರ್ಷದವರೆಗೂ ಆದ್ರೂ ಅದು ಪೂರ್ಣ ಹೋಗಿಲ್ಲ, ಇಂಥದ್ದೆಲ್ಲ ಐತೆ. ಹಂಗಿದ್ರೆ ಇದೆಲ್ಲ ಹೋಗ್ಬೇಕಾ ಅಥವಾ ಹಿಂಗ ಇರ್ಬೇಕಾ?
ಬಸವಣ್ಣವರು ಅಕ್ಕ ಮಹಾದೇವಿಯರು ಹುಟ್ಟು
ಬರ್ಬೇಕು. ಬಸವಣ್ಣವ್ರು ಹುಟ್ಟು ಬರೋದಲ್ರಿ, ಬಸವಣ್ಣವ್ರ ಗತೆ ಈಗ ನಾವು ಜಗ ಆಳಕತ್ತೀರಿ.
Only one thing is there, what we request.
And that answer is to
how long answer, is, how long this protest is, do you want to continue?
In a way you are saying, hold on here, in a way you are saying, I have a solution and I'm holding it back. You are accusing me.
Well, no,
you are saying that I must write a script.
One more,
can
one
I write a script for you? It doesn't happen like that. It doesn't happen.
Let them discuss with Vice Chancellor, na. Let them discuss
with you. Go and talk to Vice Chancellor. We want to hear each and everybody.
We are going to close it. You go and talk to Vice Chancellor.
Nobody innocently wants to study here, as if we don't understand what is going on.
ಖುದ್ ತೋ ದೂಸರೆ ಡಿಪಾರ್ಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್ಸ್ ಆಗಿ ಆರ್ಟ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಪಾಲಿಟಿಕ್ಸ್ ಸರ್ ರಿಸರ್ಚ್ ಗೋಯಿಂಗ್
You are our student friends, you are our student brothers, you are saying us, we are warning you. See, what is this?
Your brother died, man. Did you know that? Your brother died.
He's not my brother. He's not my brother.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
That's why it does not matter to you. Semester ni, 5 nellu na semester ni, 3 nellu chesinappudu evvaliki samasya raledhe. Appudu prashantanga unnare. 10 rojulu aagane manaku andarki ivanni gurtukochestunnayi.
సెమిస్టర్కి హాలిడేస్కి మాకు సంబంధం ఉందన్నమాట రీసెర్చ్ అంటే. సో అది ప్రాబ్లమే కాదు.
ఈరోజు ఈ ఫ్రాటర్నిటీ లేదని అన్న, ఈరోజు ఈ బ్రదర్హుడ్ లేదనే రోహిత్ని నిజంగా సిస్టమే చంపేసింది. ఈరోజు ఈ బ్రదర్హుడ్ లేదని అన్న, మనిషిని మనిషిగా చూడట్లేదు, మనిషిని ఒక ఐడెంటిటీగా చూస్తున్నాడని చెప్పేసి రోహిత్ ఏదైతే మాట రాశాడో ఆ మాట అందరి లోపల మైండ్లలో తిరిగిపోతుంది. మైండ్లలో తిరిగిపోయినట్టు మనిషిని మనిషిగా చూడట్లేదు అన్నది ఒక్కసారి మైండ్లలో ఫిక్స్ అయిపోయిందో జనాలకి, ఈ మళ్ళీ 10 మంది రోహిత్లు వస్తారు. దయచేసి మన సమాజంగా అట్లాంటి రోహిత్లను మనం పుట్టించొద్దన్న, మనం దానిలో ప్రాసెస్ కావద్దన్న. దయచేసి మీకు దండం పెడతాను.
ఆ ధైర్యంగా ఉండబోకండి నాన్న, ఎవరు చనిపోవడానికి ప్రయత్నించద్దు. అంబేద్కర్ గారే మనకు దేవుడు, కానీ అమ్మ ఇంపార్టెంట్. అమ్మ మెయిన్, అమ్మని ఏడిపించొద్దు. 25 ఏళ్ళు అమ్మ పెంచింది మిమ్మల్ని అంటే, ఒక అమ్మ ఏమో టైలరింగ్ చేసుకుంటుంది, ఒక అమ్మ బొచ్చులు మోస్తుంది, ఒక అమ్మ కోతలు కోస్తుంటుంది, ఒక అమ్మ ఇళ్లలో కూల్ పని చేస్తుంటుంది. అది గ్రహించుకోండి మీరు. ఎవ్వరు ఏ అధైర్యంతో ఎట్లాంటి అఘాయిత్యాలు చేయొద్దు. ఆ రోజు రోహిత్ చనిపోయినప్పుడు నేను మీడియాలో కనీస యూనివర్సిటీల్లో చదివే అమ్మలన్న బయటకు రండి అనేసి నేను ఏడ్చి మీడియా మీడియాలో పిలుపునిస్తే ఆ రోజు ఒక్క అమ్మలో రాలేదు. ఆడవాళ్ళు వందరూ నా బిడ్డను ఎందుకు చంపావనేసి వెలుగెత్తి మనం కోసం చేస్తే ఢిల్లీకి వినిపించేది. అందులో దళిత మహిళ ఎంతో శక్తివంతురాలు. అందరు బయటకు రండి, మనం మనం ప్రశ్నించే రోజు దగ్గర వచ్చింది. జై భీమ్.
Radhika Vemula, who wanted to be there at Rohit Vemula's memorial site, has been denied permission to enter here.
You dared arrest this for all the parents! I'm good now with the arrest of Maligado! We are democratically funded here!
ఎన్నోసార్లు చెప్తున్నాం, భార్గవ కమిషన్ చేసినాం, ముక్తదర్ కమిషన్లో పోలీస్ అట్రాసిటీస్ గురించి చేసినాం, శ్యామ్ సుందర్ కమిషన్లో వాళ్ళ కిల్లింగ్స్ గురించి చేసి వచ్చినాం, కోర్టులో కేసు వేసినాం, ఎన్హెచ్ఆర్సీ ఫైండింగ్స్ ఇచ్చినాయి. హౌ కెన్ యూ కాల్ యువర్ సెల్ఫ్ వెల్ ఎలక్టెడ్ పీపుల్స్ రిప్రజెంటేటివ్ ఇఫ్ యూఆర్ నాట్ ఏబుల్ టు చెక్ ది ఇంప్యూనిటీ యూఆర్ గ్రాంటెడ్ టు ద పోలీస్? ఫర్ 35 ఇయర్స్ దిస్ ఇంప్యూనిటీ ఈస్ గోయింగ్ ఆన్ ఇన్ దిస్ కంట్రీ. ఫర్ 35 ఇయర్స్ ఇన్ దిస్ స్టేట్ ఐఎమ్ విట్నెసింగ్ దిస్ ఇంప్యూనిటీ. Anybody connected with the government is sanctioned impunity. That's what it has come to. There must be a limit to this kind of a thing.
I will not really rest until government killings stop. Government should not have the power either to delegate or to itself take to killing people.
It is increasing all over the globe. It is not simply India. I have full confidence that someday or other, whether I am alive or not, efforts of people like us will not fail. We have been fighting for so many years. We can't suddenly say that no, this is not possible, we want to close shop. No. So far as human life is concerned, such an attitude cannot be taken. We'll carry on. And someday I'm sure even Sisyphus would have dreamt that he will roll the stone to the hilltop. And I do believe in that.
Thank you, PLD, for sharing your screen. I've watched these films several times, but it always makes me pause and I have to take a deep breath. And thanks, Deepa, once again. Some of you might have seen some of these films, some of you may have seen all of them, but clearly there's a very wide range of films that Deepa has made these 40 years. And they span a range of concerns and interests. And what holds them together, as I understand her work, is her vision as a feminist. And in one of our conversations, she said, to her, feminism is an entire ecosystem, something that one builds throughout. It isn't something that is given and stays stationary all the time. So your experiences, what you read, what you listen, they together make up this ecosystem. We'll, of course, come back to discussing that ecosystem, but I actually want to start with her very early film, which is the 1981 film, the tobacco workers of Nipani. And she'd made a couple of other films at around the same time. One was on the feminist, what I would like to call the feminist discovery of domestic distress. You know, the problem that Betty Friedan said does not have a name yet in the US context. And I think the discovery of conjugal unhappiness and of the space of the home as a space of distress. And that is something that that film deals with. And the other film that she made around the same time was on domestic workers in Pune. And if you see those films together, you see women talking, fighting, arguing, thinking together. And you see a world, a life world that is usually not present to us even today. Women occupying their own interior spaces, but also the outside world, and negotiating those with great, great creativity. And it must have been a very new experience capturing these on camera for a general audience, not just a feminist audience. So I'd like to start, Deepa, by asking you, were there any precedents to this sort of filmmaking? What were you inspired by or guided by when you showed us these phenomenon of women speaking, thinking, saying things on screen that many of us perhaps hadn't heard before?
So so just to begin with saying that the first three films that we did was part of, we had started a film collective called Yugantar. And the members were Abha Bhaiya, who we all know now, one of the founding members of Saheli. She's gone on to start Jagori, is still very active. Then there was Navroz Contractor, who was actually the only film, the person proficient in filmmaking. We were all amateurs, who's a cinematographer and graduate from FTII. There was Meera Rao, who was a writer. And when we actually, this collective, the idea for this collective, some of you may remember the very first autonomous women's movement meeting, which was held in Bombay. I don't know. I think I see Manisha here. Manisha, maybe you were there then. So, you know, at the time, it's not just 1980, but I think even emergency, post-emergency, you already had a lot of women who were coming out of left movements, who were looking for a space that where they could raise those kind of concerns, those issues. Those sort of nebulous formations were taking place, discussions were happening, little publications were being published. So this had already started, you know, I think from 77 onwards. So by the time we came to like late 79, I remember Abha and I at that stage. Also to describe that the women's movement at the time was such an exciting space to be in, you know. And I think we talk a lot about the politics, we never talk about just how pleasurable it was, you know, to be with women, to be part of these discussions, part of these protests. It seems like endlessly women were on the street, you know. You would find so many things, whether it was price rise or whether it was obscenity in cinema, whether it was dowry murders. So in that kind of very heady, very exciting space, Abha and I actually one day met, and we, and just for some of you, this is some more history. We had this conversation, and then she got on a train. And that's where the name Saheli, what would we call this group in Delhi, Saheli, it came to her in that train journey after we spoke. But so when we were talking, and then there was this excitement, and we said, you know, why don't we just try? And it was a very narrow idea at that time that let's just document, for example, what's happening with women in the informal sector and unionization, women and work, women and labor. This was the kind of scope of what we were thinking at the time. And we had known about the domestic workers union in Pune that had been formed, also what was happening in Nepal. So initially, you know, when you talk about precedents, I can't think of film precedents, really. I can't think of that kind of thing. But it was really a practice that was generated as we did it. You know, it was a process. The process had many aspects, you know, in the sense of what were we observing, what were the conversations we were having with women. And then how do you create a vehicle or some kind of formal structure to contain the radical potential of what we were listening and watching, you know? This is how we started. And you'll see in the first film, for example, we were much more, I won't use the word amateurish, I should say amateurish actually, because everything was new. We couldn't meet the domestic workers directly. We had to go through the union leaders and some of them were male. It was not easy. There were many gatekeepers. It was difficult also negotiating because of course there was suspicion, like, who are you people? Why are you here? What do you want to do? So many, many challenges that had to be worked through, right? But I think the spark for me, I think even in the first film, which of course has stayed for me ever since, has just been the, I would call it voice in the broadest sense of that word, not just literally, but in every sense of how women present their selves intact, you know, that whenever women got together, even in these union meetings, even in Molkarin, for example, there is a space and there is a way in which if you can see a kind of political consciousness be birthed, I can't explain it any other way. You know, you can see like the way, for example, their insistence on having Molkarin in the title, and there was a big discussion because they said this gives us the legitimacy of workers. You know? The concept that work that is stigmatized because domestic work is stigmatized, it also has a caste stigma attached to it because you're washing people's dirty, you know, jute vessels, you're washing soiled clothes. So even how do you talk about stigma? How do you talk about how you're treated where plates are kept apart, glasses are kept apart? There are certain space things that they can't touch or access, even those kind of things. Then conversations about how their labor actually frees up their employer's labor, many women, their Malkins, who can then participate in a very lucrative economy, right? But every time their wages and the way that's calculated, or there's always an issue with barely survival wages, you know, really. So I think it's in those discussions, I think that's where the first idea came that, you know, what we have to just, if you like, present this process as we've seen it, you know, and somehow underline or mark the incredible way in which they are presenting themselves. So it was not about us representing or having, in fact, I have to say, even thinking about representation in the way today people talk about it, like film theory or film people, like, you know, it was really, could we convey the excitement and could we convey the just, you know, jaw dropping what we were watching? I mean, I think that's how it started. And what I loosely call the power of the speaking group and voice and how, you know, that kind of political subjecthood that's being created as we watch, that somehow, I don't know, even if you see the clips, like I'm watching it now, and actually before this, I watched all my films. It really began in 1980 with that. And somehow that has stayed, you know, this way of watching women theorize their struggle, their location, their the way they see the issues that they are embedded in. That has sort of stayed, I think in all of my work.
Right. Deepa, I just want to pick on some of the things you've pointed out. One is that while we have many histories of the women's movements, and since this is also about archiving, there is, I think at least, a difference in the different sources that we access to create this history of the women's movements. And while print does it in a certain way, films do this in a very different way. And some of the things that you pointed out, what do we remember about that time? And I think this is true for anyone who's been part of feminist spaces, the sheer joy of being together, energy and the happiness that comes from collectivity, female comradeship at one level. Feminist politics, which is so much, as you say, in the doing. It's not that one had this plan and one followed this plan, but you know, you sort of also thought through and made up as you went along. And in your films, you actually present that process in some ways. There is the experience of what women undergo, and then there is a voice. Sometimes it's an individual voice, sometimes it speaks on behalf of a collective, but say in Invoking Justice, the individual woman who's part of the women's Jamaat, she listens to the male Jamaat, and then she tells us how to read that. Yeah. And she's of course only not just speaking as herself, she is of course saying it in a manner that references her own experience, but she has the entire voice of the Jamaat behind her. So, and considering so many of your films are about women in movement, so to speak, women fighting, arguing, thinking, and so on and so forth, could you sort of just tell us what is it about these feminist spaces that you found it difficult or easy to translate into a visual medium? Because in print, I think at least, that there is a certain givenness, you know, you tell the story and it seems like it's fixed in time. But when you watch a film, you also see those faces, you see bodies, you see people, you know, in conversation. So there's something about the visual media which is unique. And did you sort of have to work that through, or did that also emerge in the doing?
I think it you can't take it apart, you know, you can't really pull these elements apart. I think, okay, for the first part of what you asked, you know, I think the what is, if I think about it over time, what is really, what draws me to certain subjects, or what draws me to, and why I'm so drawn to seeing women take on challenges. See, it doesn't even have to be, it can be a move, like for example, the Jamaat. Now that is a very concrete example of women taking on many institutions. But it can also be like in the other films where you see the way they analyze the situation, which just goes against the grain of, that for me is very exciting. You know, I'm drawn to subjects or situations where you can interrogate something. Whether it's the family planning program, whether it's alternate dispute resolution like in the Jamaat or Nari Adalat, whether or even the difficulties of creating a women's union. You know, can we? So I'm drawn to subjects where we can interrogate this, and at the same time, with the kind of brilliance that women bring to these struggles and how they really turn so many of these things on their head, you know. In something like a war, for example, at the time, I have to tell you, it was completely shocking for a film. Of course, there had been many books and articles and things like that to actually criticize the program from within, from the women who are actually targets of the program, as to how they experience it, how they experience the healthcare system, how they experience what happens, this ghastly collusion with family and state actors and the healthcare system, the exposing the corruption within the system. So I think that, so Geeta, you have to stop me, I think I'm rambling on.
No,
go on. I think that's what draws me to certain subjects. There is also the question of how do we put it? You know, I'm asked this actually after making We Have Not Come Here to Die. I mean, a lot of people brought this up about what is it with caste and why so many of my films actually have touched on caste in many different ways. And I'm talking about it because when it came up as to how can you as a upper middle class, non-Dalit, Savarna woman, filmmaker, you know, how do you make films on these questions? And I was thinking about it a lot. And I thought, you know, I have an answer, but that works for all of my work. And the answer is that I gave at the time was that, you know, it's not about, it's really about not looking at it in the way of caste and identities and identity politics. For me, it's about taking an anti-caste position. Can we just take an anti-caste way of framing a situation, you know? Similarly, I would say with all the other work, can we take a way of looking at it that is feminist in the most, I would put it like that. So it comes from a desire to also be a partner in intervening in these debates,
right?
You know, or to be in alliance with, in some sense.
Yeah.
With certain movements, certain positions. So it's not only, for me, it's not just about a topic or a subject or, you move on. There are certain things that over 40 years, I keep coming back to again and again, you know?
Right. I know. The thing is, what is interesting is even in these early films, I mean, throughout the, if you look at your body of work, what you actually see is that women's lives are simply not about those experiences that you show and which they theorize, but there's such a world that makes those experiences, right? It's caste on the one hand, it's the state on the other, it's conjugality. So there's all these things that come together. And very importantly, the differences between women, you know, the working class woman who has to work in her middle class or lower middle class household and the tension there, or the mother-in-law, daughter-in-law in the film that you, where the Sri Sakti Sangatna group actually acts in the film entirely. Domestic discord. So there is that whole tension between, yes, we are the women's movement. We are speaking as a vulnerable sisterhood, so to say, but there is also this very, very, very specific ways in which we suffer and endure, you know? And I think this is where I want to come back to something which I don't want you to rush away and not answer, which is that the camera captures some of this stuff in very interesting ways, like in the We Have Not Come Here to Die, two groups of students, right? And one of them does not want this to be disrupted. And the others are saying, but aren't you your brother's keeper, more or less? And you see that whole caste gender tension when that girl says, for one student's sake, you know, why we are all suffering. So I think the camera does some things which perhaps words cannot do in so many ways. So which is why I want, if you can tell us, that whole thing about translating it into the visual medium, is there anything that you would like to sort of share with us from any of these films, like something like A War, where a complex idea or a point of view, you had to find a visual equivalent, which was important.
Okay, so I think let's take something like A War. More people have seen that. Basically, there's sort of two parallel tracks in that film, okay? One is actually the sterilization camps and the hospitals and the clinical trials and that whole part of it. And this in counterpoint is with the women's group discussion which we had in Rajasthan with women. So in that, I think the discussion, and here I must talk about Navroz and his camera and his eye, you know, and I think the way he films women, I've said this, it's a very affectionate and tender gaze, you know, it is, and if you see something like A War, I mean, the women's group discussion, the discussion with the women, you really see that tenderness, the affection, the intimacy, the way it's filmed, you know. The clip I chose here really is not, I mean, it's much more about catching the conversation as it happens live. But in the other parts of the film where we have those discussions, you'll see that there's an extraordinary intimacy in those moments, you know. And that's very much the way he films. And also to tell you that he sat in the circle, you know, at the same eye level with the camera on his shoulder. So there is that intimacy of feeling that you're within it. And it's remarkable that the women just accepted him and forgot he was there. And that the most intimate kind of things that are being said also goes to show how he can handle a camera in those circumstances. So that was decided. Now, the camp portions or those kind of things, which was, we had some discussion earlier about how to cover that kind of thing, but that was much more, you know, you have to think of a different way to film that so that it'll be in counterpoint, you know. So at times when you can have these discussions prior, it's one thing, but there's some horrible thing going on outside. Yeah. But often, like for example, in the We Have Not Come Here to Die film, there was hardly any time to talk, you know, because everything is just exploding in front of the lens. You know, you just have to have eyes in the back of your head and run around trying to capture it all. That's very whole other thing. And again, there his brilliance and his reflexes, you know, of just being the camera being there and when something's happening. And so I would say each film, Geeta, has a different, we have to come up with a different aesthetic, you know, you have to come up with so I don't have like a formal attachment or investment in any form, really. It's that the particular subject, where we are, the shooting conditions, all that determines what this can be. I mean, if you look at the Jamaat film, for example, it's mostly women sitting and talking.
Yes.
And people may find that visually monotonous, but I said there's no other way to do it because you have to show the electricity and the energy of the group. And the only way you can do that is just to sit there again and film them, yes, you know, as they're doing that. We have the little verite sequences here and there, but 80% of the film is just that, you know?
Yes. Yes. So what's fascinating is that you do while some of these things are only about the voice, Advocate is also like that. You have a lot of people talking. But what I find fascinating is while each film demands its own aesthetic and so much of it has to do with the circumstances in which you film, the state of mind of the group. I know what a difficult time the Jamaat gave you. I mean, you would ask them to put off the fan and they would say, no, we can't, and you can't make us do this. I mean, but there's also a relationship that you build over a period of time with the groups. And I think while we were speaking, Amu Joseph had wanted you to say something about how Gyasibai, what did you have to say about Navroz? But maybe you can do that later. But basically also that you have sort of found a way of sequencing your films so that we never see you as a filmmaker intruding, so to speak, but there's a curation of voices, a collective feminist voice, which is not a boring, flattened out voice, but which captures the richness of what many people say on camera through the making of the film. And there's a way in which sort of suddenly there's somebody who captures it all for you, you know, in a phrase or a sentence. And so there is a certain aesthetic that you work towards, like, you know, Radhika Vemula saying, Ambedkar is our God, but Amma Mainu. You know?
Amma Mainu.
Amma Mainu, she says. I mean, that's such a one-liner. So yeah. I think there's a way in which you're also listening and capturing. So it's at the editing table, obviously, you spend a lot of time. And is there anything you'd like to share with us about something that you would
I have to say that, you know, filmmaking and documentary film, really, it is a collective activity, you know. And I have been really lucky, I mean, working with Navroz consistently, but also very lucky in the people I've edited with. And I would really like to talk about Jabeen Merchant, for example, and the kind of relationship we have. And I would say that, you know, the thing with documentaries, and especially documentaries that are about live events and, you know, things that you're chasing a story or you're chasing certain narratives, you know, that those kind of things, then to create something coherent out of it, her work and her standing outside my emotional investment in certain bits of the footage which I adore and love and get very attached to. And it is a very intense collaborative process where we really have to work together, and her contribution is immense. You know, it is really immense. See, that is one kind of film. Now, when we talk about The Advocate, you see, The Advocate literally started with us filming something like 18 to 20 hours of K.G. Kannabiran actually speaking, just speaking. I mean, these were these conversations where he spoke about his cases, he spoke about his analyses of law. It was so rich, you know. We had, that's how we started it. Now, finally, when we came back and looked at that material and went back and filmed again with him many times over like 4 years, 5 years. Then again, it became very clear that the film really had to be we had to give the audience the same opportunity that we got of literally sitting at his feet and listening to him, because he's an amazing speaker, very personable, great raconteur, and also very funny. He's just riveting, you know. So then it became very clear that the film would just have to be, in that sense, him speaking, and we had other people who were around him at that time. And in that film, you know, again with Jabeen, it's very difficult because the film is like an hour and a half long, and you have to create so many layers only through speech. There's minimal visual footage in that film.
Right.
Right. The second half maybe a little bit more, but and then so how that's a whole other way of editing. That's a whole other way of making meaning, where you introduce an idea at some point and then you come back to it in the middle, you get out of it again. You know, it's as complicated as editing something that's visually very exciting and, you know, very current and happening and a lot of drama. Yeah. It's as tough, you know.
I want us to, because we may not have too much time, but I want us to also reflect at this point is that many of your films constitute an archive of the women's movement almost, you know. You start with the issues that animated the women's movements to do with violence. But interestingly, you don't pick on sexual assault, but you pick on the female body, on bodily integrity, health, well-being, women working. And then, of course, this whole thing about the state. We've engaged with the state at so many different levels, but the state through family planning is such a different approach to thinking that history through. And then sexuality, which is a very central aspect. And that's an aspect that you see in something like A War, when the women talk about what gives them pleasure, you know, that's a very nice part of the film. Mm-hmm. But you've also come to sexuality through other means, like in this really interesting film that you made, I think in 2006, is it? Love in the Time of AIDS, which is a very unusual film for me because it's also about bodily integrity. And the whole phenomenon of queerness and what does that mean, and how do you inhabit those bodies, and how do you actually represent them? So there's a very rich world that you bring to the screen, and we actually walk through the history of the women's movements in some ways. But in all of these films, just to go back to what you said, you want to give us what you yourself encounter when you meet people and you sort of, you know, take a camera to their voices and their settings and so on. And so if I may phrase it like this, these films are also in some ways very subtly pedagogic. Not in a straightforward way or a boring way, but pedagogy as politics in the best sense of the word. And you've also done pedagogic films that are my absolute favorite, The Young Historians and many others. You've done films for Panchayati Raj, training support. You've done lots of things for English teaching to first generation learners. Now, feminists, of course, have invested a lot in consciousness raising across the world. And we've learned from each other, learned from listening and talking. So how would you describe your interest in pedagogy? And after that, I'll just have one other last question. But this I would like us to know, because this is such an important aspect of your work. It's the way you see feminist process itself. It's a learning experience. So just a few reflections on that.
I think You know, see, when we start, I have to say that the Yugandhar videos, in a sense, the intention was pedagogic, you know, because the idea was that we make these films, particularly on, particularly the union films, for example, and can we then bring them to other, for example, construction workers or BD workers in other areas, and can it be a kind of not a handbook or a playbook or something about, you know, the positive advantages to unionize, or what are the challenges of unionizing? So, in a sense, you know, we began with that kind of, it was a very overt intention that we would, you know, and it's interesting that these films have just been restored, by the way. These films had disappeared and they've just been restored digitally. And we had a screening of the Nipani film actually 3 years ago with garment workers, domestic workers in Bangalore. And it's so fascinating that they said, this is old school union politics, but give us a Kannada version, we can still use it. It's still a handbook on how to unionize, you see? So now this is how we began. I think if you look at Something Like a War was, you know, at the time there were the women's movement, there were cases in court against ICMR, you know, there were protests being held, there were challenges to the whole issue of consent, there were cases about Netin and injectable contraceptives. There was, you know, all that was happening at the time. So Something Like a War definitely was made with the idea of somehow intervening through film, but bringing that kind of politics or analysis that was emerging from how feminist groups all over the country were talking about reproductive health and population control, you know, all those debates, right? So it was supposed to be that kind of film. It was supposed to be a film that could be used in the same way as the other interventions. So again, pedagogic, you know, I admit it. Yeah, that's really, and I'm not at all surprised that so many of my films are used in teaching. It's not surprising to me. So this idea, it is a bit suspect, you know, this thing of trying to use film to teach in that sense. That's one angle. But directly, I mean, I think my fascination with first generation learners, and I've had the opportunity, actually, that is with students, but also the first time, which was when the first Panchayati Raj elections in Karnataka, and we created actually video materials, you know, for the first round of elected members. There was something like 43,000 women who were elected for the first time in Karnataka state. And it was an amazing experience because, you know, there was this marvelous IAS officer called Anita Kaul who gave us complete access and a free hand. So, you know, and at that time, the idea of really, like, you look at the act, you know, you had to look at the act. You had to look at the conditions where, say, SC Gram Panchayat women representatives for the first time, what would they need? What would they need really to function in these spaces, right? So from that kind of material, that was a huge project. I mean, and I'm very, you know, pleased to say that material was used for years in administrative training institutes and with the next round of elected women representatives as well. You know, it was used. It was used for at least, I think, 12 or 15 years, right? After that, we get into doing something with primary school teachers, you know, how you can interrogate really not just also the physical classroom, but really why do first generation students drop out, you know, Dalit students, Adivasi students, minority students particularly. And to start a whole, create a space where teachers themselves can start talking honestly about what is going on in these classrooms, you know. That was another whole experience, which is also, again, like something like 101,40,000 primary school teachers, again, had to, you know, were introduced to this video material along with other things, you know. From there, I go into actually, for the first time, doing material for children. This is a whole other challenge, okay? Completely different challenge. And the history series that you saw, that was something where we were actually creating pedagogy, you know? We stayed in Gadag in this village for 2.5 months with these children. And every day, the idea was not to teach history, but to teach historiography, to give children an experience. What do historians do? You know, we know, I mean, in our school, you know, all over, like how history is now, you know, it's so contentious, right? Whether it's mythology, folklore, textbooks are changed all the time. The only thing we thought we could do is how do you foster creative thinking, you know, and critical thinking in children. So whatever book is really hurled at them, they have some tools to understand it. So in that instance, we would literally create activities, film children doing them, have discussions, our own discussions, working or not. A lot of it didn't work because, you know, I mean, we were making it up. We just tried to use this very Socratic method of being guided by children's curiosity. No answer was considered foolish or ignorant. The teacher was always, would tackle any question, anything that they raised. The teacher would follow students' curiosity or inquiry. You know, we had so many ground rules. And the other thing about even language in these groups, when children spoke about, you know, so how certain words, certain ways of kids being with each other, how do you create a respectful, fearless, and democratic classroom, right? Not just among children, but even the teacher, this, you know, this very imposing authoritarian figure in the classroom. So the pedagogy we created had to encompass all of that, you know? It's not just content of what we're teaching. So that thing, that I hope I've divided it, I mean, in terms of...
Yes. No, it's fascinating because I think there's so much that I want to ask, but I also must give others a chance to talk to you.
Thanks.
So what I want to just sort of just say and give you the last word is that from, my endless conversations with you over many years and the films and other things, there are three things that I just want to flag off, and you can respond to them in whatever manner you wish. Mm-hmm. One is, of course, that your films, if viewed as an archive of the women's movements, show us the differences and the richness of these movements as they emerged across the country. Because I think one of the most important things in these films are the number of sites that you visited, the number of languages that you actually hear, you know, and which is very important, because otherwise there's a tendency to imagine the women's movement spoke in English. It didn't. So that is a very, very, very rich experience that you get from the films. The second is the way in which feminism itself evolves. You call it an ecosystem, you know, that it's not something that is an ideology that is everywhere and nowhere, some of us like to believe when they say, oh, there are feminisms. No, it's very clearly it has to do with women's lives, with the politics of reproduction, home, relationships, and the way in which caste and kinship and the state and everything else constituted, and we constitute those as well. But what you also make us do as feminist politics, to listen to women, which is so important. I remember anyone, and there are many lawyers here who've been to court, who have taken up issues pertaining to violence against women, that women are not listened to, they're not believed. So I think there's this whole thing of, you know, listening to women, taking them seriously, which you show so fantastically. And thirdly, that people, including women and children also, it's people who actually make thought. Thought is not something that intellectuals create, you know.
Yeah.
Always after the fact, we are recording what's happened on the ground. So I think that's also something that your films capture. So I think these are some very, very rich things that I have personally got from your films. Now, can you do the impossible? Respond to some of these things in 3 minutes so that we can take up some of these questions. And I mean, I'm sorry, but you know.
I don't know where to begin, really. See, when I say it's an ecosystem, you know, I mean, I think, you know, there is no, that, you know, people always are, the way people talk about how they came into political, well, subjecthood, it sounds sounds a little too didactic, but you know what I mean. They always describe a moment or an event or something that, you know, all the alarm bells go off. But I don't think it is, I don't think for us, you know, like coming out of the emergency, you know, and you have the whole experience of what was happening at the time, the way you look at state, the way you look at the criminal justice system. And don't forget, it was a time of incredible violence, you know, which I think now, when people talk about the emergency, they only talk about people who were imprisoned. But for example, in Andhra, I mean, you know, the encounter was born there. I mean, how many students were shot and killed, and what was happening on campuses, right, at the time, okay? So I think, you know, it is very gradual and layered, you know, it's not. And then when you come into this understanding of the women's question or these debates, you know, or you read, there is also reading, there is also the whole birth of the women's studies starts, you know, people are doing research. So the ecosystem is all of these things, and how do they impinge on your consciousness, and what do you take from it, you know? I think the other thing I have to admit is that, you know, I'm a total glutton for research. I just love, I mean, in another life, like, I think I would have been a very happy researcher. That's part of it I love. I mean, you know, so, you know, just, and there is so much, you know, already, I mean, as I'm saying, this, when we started doing something like a war, I mean, the amount of material that is being created, even by Saheli, I mean, think of Satyamala's work, you know? Absolutely. I mean, fantastic. I mean, think of what Sri Shakti was doing in Hyderabad at the time, and the kind of, think of Meera Shiva, you know, what she was talking about. Think of Akhila Shivdas, you know, people who were talking about the way statistics were being cooked by the government, for example, right? So, this is all, you know, it's the way I'm wired, I think, you know, that's what I mean by eco space. And I'm sorry, Geeta, I think I've forgotten everything.
Just that you have also been very particular about thought as a collective event, you know, that people think together and women think together. So if you can just end with that, that'll be very nice. If you want to say
something? I think I have to say something also that, you know, at the time, you know, the generosity of sharing, whether it was ideas, whether it was, you know, material, conversations, time. And I think that made such an impact on me in a sense that, you know, intuitively and unconsciously, I actually never make film about, I've never made a film about an individual woman, right? They're always either it's a group I put together, or it's a collective, or it's a, I think that somewhere intuitively what I'm trying to honor is that the idea of knowledge and wisdom being created collectively in that interaction between women, right, in the storytelling. And the other thing I have to say, you said, talked about many languages and things, you know, I love listening. I love voice. Okay. I'm so drawn to women's speech, and particularly, I'll tell you, particularly unlettered women. Okay. My God, the richness of it, you know, whether it's irony, humor, proverbs, sayings, I mean, and the wit, you know, it's just an English, you know, flattens everything. You try and subtitle anything in English, I'm dying. I hate that, you know, it flattens the power of that speech. And I really feel, I dare say this, I don't know, I may get bashed up, but there is something about female speech which is very distinct. And different, you know, it is, anyway, I won't give you too many, except it is really different speech. You know, when we made the Gram Panchayat Raj film, at that point, there was a woman again from North Karnataka called Sharnava. And, you know, we were discussing again in a group, we were discussing, okay, so what does reservation mean for Dalit women? And she said, you know, before reservation, we were treated, you know, those, I don't know how to say, I can't say it in Kannada, but in English, the very poor translation, you know, like those mangy cur, you know, mangy dogs, mangy old sick dogs who on the street people avoid when they walk past. She said that's how we were treated before reservation. And now these same fellows who treated us like that, they have to tolerate it if we come and sit in the office. We may not say anything in the office, but they have to tolerate us sitting there. And just look at that expression. You know how hard I struggled to subtitle that, right?
I can imagine. But, you know, but that is the joy of also being in the women's movements, that we learn all the time through these various voices, as you say. Yeah. And just to sort of end this conversation with, just to point out that there is such a rich history of care, of labor, of looking to other women, of listening to each other, which makes feminist politics. And while we have our contentions and our arguments and our fights, and we must fight, of course, there's plenty to be fighting about, that whole sense of solidarity and comradeship across arguments and fights is something that perhaps is so needed more than anything else now. We could go on, but we really must end now and take time for questions. But I want to just request PLD to play the last clip from Vachanas. This is a beautiful song from Basavanna from North Karnataka, where the bhakti world is still alive and people do sing these songs as a matter of course, and children learn them in a very sort of unforced kind of way. And I think given the times and given Deepa's own investment in language, this is a good way to end this conversation, after which we'll take up your questions. The last clip, please.
Yeah, one sec, Yashu. Yes. I just want to say one more thing before we finish this, is that, you know, you said, you know, it's, I also want to say that this listening, paying attention and being in really present to people and in the presence of people with that kind of complete attention, it's not just me. It's also Navroz's camera that does that. You do get the entire, you know, there is a way, I feel, I don't know, people who watch the films also can tell me that, but that whole thing of listening with complete attention, you know, people say different things, you know, we bear witness and all of that. But for me, it is that, you know, it is that listening with being present with complete, you're completely there, you know. And I think that while I may be doing it physically, I think his camera really supports that. And I think Jabeen and the other editors I work with also you know how to bring that in the pacing, in the rhythm, in how you will experience that moment, you know, that we shared. Anyway, sorry, now we can just...
No. The last clip.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. There are already some questions in the question box. I'm just going to very quickly summarize that for you, Deepa. One is, you talked about gatekeepers. Could you share any story how you crossed those barriers? And you want to take each question as it comes, or should I?
Yeah, whatever is...
Yeah, so there are three questions from Pragna Joshi. One is that about gatekeepers and how do you cross those barriers? And at that time, people sort of desisted being called feminist, and how did you convince them that you wanted to sort of, you know, about the feminist lens, how did you convince them? And what did you want to bring through these films beyond documentation? Did you ever find that the so-called target group, women's personal lives, and within their families and their intimate relationships, were very segregated from their public lives, and they were part of unions and so on? Did you catch anything of this on your lens? And there's the another question from Manisha. I think she will probably want to ask the question. So if you can respond to these first.
Okay. Yeah, as far as gatekeepers go, see, it's a huge process of negotiation. You know, like the first film that we did, Molkarin, we could only meet the union women through the leaders, right? And it took time because, you know, you also have to build trust. I mean, they don't know who you are. They don't know why they should be part of such a project. So there's a lot of negotiation, but also, you know, you have to understand when you're dealing with left unions, right? There is a way. Also, you know, the in a sense that, you know, the whole class character of the movement or the kind of things that they wonder whether you will, you know, whether you're going to tell their story or the way they view what they're doing, their processes in a particular way. So that film was quite a challenge, actually, in many levels to try and work through this situation. But the second film, the Nipani film, what we did, which is we took a different tack, which is we just went to Nipani and we stayed in that basti for 3 months, where most of the women go to the factory from that basti. So, you know, we just stayed there for 3 months, and it was a question of every evening or whenever women had time, they would come in, they would we would chat, we would speak, we would ask about what work was like, why they decided to unionize. So there was a period of, you know, where by that time, and also very often our discussions were, what do you want to share about what you have done? What should be in the film, literally as like that? And so finally, when we made the film, it is the women who introduced us to Subhash Joshi, who was the leader of the union. You know, it was a reverse, process. And in that, the women were very active in the sense that they literally, the strike that you saw, that clip that you saw, actually is actually reenacted. And this is something they said, you have to put it in the film because there were so many of us. And that's what broke the backs of the workers. And I said, how will you organize it? How will you get 500 women or 1,000 women? And how can we do this? And they said, just leave it to us. We'll do it, you know? So that is a different way where, you know, the women took ownership of the film, and then they became the people who were mediating. So there was no mediation involved after a while, because even Mr. Subhash Joshi knew that there were enough conversations, enough trust that was built, right? And now the thing about feminist and what I'd like to say is, you know, at the time, see, we were not, while we were having intense and deep conversations about women's work, labor, status, I mean, both the family as an institution, the workplace, everything. But we were not using words like feminist at that point. No? You have to, it hadn't come out as a label then. We were still in those first three films. Definitely it was more about the conversations we'd have with women were you know, what do you want to share about your lives and things like that. I will say that because the focus was on the union and unionizing, that what and there what we chose to prioritize, and today I feel bad that what we chose to leave out was really women, the negotiation women were doing with families to be in public life, you know. And there was one Muslim woman, she's in the film actually, and she's giving this amazing speech, rousing speech, real firebrand kind of activist. And there was one a protest meeting where she went up to this police inspector and she held on to his mustaches and took her feet off the ground. So can you imagine? Yeah. And it was just, you know, and of course they beat her to the ground and fractured her arm, you know. Now she goes home with the sari over the arm, doesn't tell the family what has happened, okay? Because the next day she wants to be back at that protest meeting. Now, can you imagine? I mean, we had this story from her, okay? And yeah, I think it's just the limitations of our political understanding at the time, you know, how we, I admit it, right? The other thing, imagine in Nipani, more 90% of the women who were working in these factories were Devdasis from that community. Many of them had come back from Bombay or various places that they had been trafficked. You'll see, if you see actually in the factory footage, you'll see how many older women are there. Actually, it's really older women who are working there. And except for one section, which we did keep about the kind of sexual exploitation on the factory floor, and we've kept that bit. But what's interesting is that we haven't added the bit that because they are from this Devdasi community, right? There is that attendant sense of that they are available in you know, in a weird, in that kind of way. And when women were talking about their employers or whatever it is and wanting that to stop, they weren't, it was fascinating. They were talking about removing all this kind of upper caste oppression, which was not only sexual. There were many, many other things. Abusive language, for example, or caste-based abuses, you know, various things. They had a whole set of things. And again, somehow that, though it was there, I mean, we had heard it and it didn't. Yeah, so I think there are times, you know, what your political understanding is. And we were growing film to film. I mean, you know, you have to understand, like, Navroz was a professionally trained camera person, right? I had worked as an assistant director for some feature film projects, but you're just a gopher, you know, you're not really learning about how to make films. You're running around in costumes, keeping it in, you know, continuity, getting props, giving the script to the actors. You don't really learn about making films, okay? So with each film, I mean, imagine the challenges. There was this process of how to work with women, how to figure out what was going on, how to really work in partnership and create a practice for doing that, which I call that's what I call a feminist practice. That's a feminist practice of work, you know? So it's artisanal, yeah, it's work. It's like, you know, you learn from each project. That's going on one side. And then, you know, I remember when we shot Molkarin and we take the footage to the editor, and he was teaching film in the Film Institute. This guy, he looks at it and said, so? I said, what? So he said, that's it? I said, yeah, that's it. Nothing more. I said, no, that's it. So he said, like, how do you shoot like this? Like, you know, how do you come with so little? Like, what do you want me to do? You know, I'm just saying there were so many challenges of how to work through learning how to make films, all these kind of processes. Yeah. Okay, what was the last thing?
I think you answered the last thing as well. I answered everything, but... I think Manisha just wanted to share that story about Ghazibai and
Navroz. I must say it. Yeah. It's very, you know, it's in the discussion it's in that session where the women are doing this exercise of pleasure and pain, and they, you know, there's a drawing of the female body and they point to certain parts of the body and then they speak about why that part gives them pleasure or pain. And while that exercise is going on, Ghazibai, who was, I think, the most brilliant ideologue, really. And she looks really mischievously right into the camera, straight at Navroz, and says, you know, I want an old man like him. And of course, all of them start laughing and they say, how does he look old to you? And then she says something very moving. She says, you know, when your children die, and many of her children had died, she said, when your children die, at least if you have an old man, you know, you have a companion, you know, you can at least eat together, be together, you know. It is something, you know, that companionship, you know. I want one like him, she said, very, you know, archly like that. And Abha said, yeah, so since a few days, you've been thinking about this, huh? You've been thinking about this, about him in this way. We've just kept that bit, you know. We just kept that bit. It's just so beautiful. It's like, that was it.
Any other questions? I don't see any in the Q&A. Anyone else with questions?
Just wanted to point out there is a question on Facebook, which says, how have visual histories of women or the feminist movement been challenged or expanded by the emergence of queer movements, where the very idea of woman or the gender binary has also become difficult to sustain? This is clearly not a new idea. It's embedded in your work, if not explicitly.
Okay, so I don't know if what I'm going to say will answer that, but I will talk to you. See, we made a film about love in the time of AIDS, and this is a film about basically Kotis in Belgaum, and it was a film actually that where we really tried in a very free flowing kind of way to bring in stories of whether it was, you know, the complexities of being living as Kotis in a very small town. Most of them lived in villages around that small town, Belvanaki. But the stories were really about how complex the lives are, because they, you know, whether it is stories of desire, stories of criminality, stories of discrimination, stories of caste, stories of so it is a very complex telling of these worlds. Now the visual treatment in that was actually one should have made a film on how difficult it was to find spaces in which we could film with them publicly, you know. So all the time we would also have to create setups, right? Because it's not easy. They didn't want to be seen with the crew, you know. They didn't want to be seen with a film crew. So one person, actually, his house, he stays somewhere with his lover, and so he said, this is the kind of thing I do in the house. I said, okay. So we found somebody else's house where we sort of recreated what he did. We found a tailor shop that wasn't the tailor shop that this person belonged in. At that time, I must say, this is in the early 2000s. So there were a lot of challenges in trying to do this in a very small town, in a kind of rural area. There's different kind of challenges. I don't think I've answered your question, but about visually what one does. But I think the challenge of how do you present this very, very complex subjectivity, it is a huge challenge, I think. How does one do it? I think, you see, every film is a challenge, you know. How do you, what is your intention? What's your beginning point? How do you come to a form? How do you, we all know this, documentary filmmakers.
Well, I think it's also, if I may just add before we conclude, I don't know if we have too much time after this, unless there are some very urgent questions, that Deepa's films are concerned with bodily integrity, you know, and whether it's the state that is targeting the body, whether it's the police, whether it's conditions of labor, and how each of us owns up to our bodies or cannot own up to our bodies, a way in which we hold ourselves with dignity and with a struggle to hold ourselves together, you know, ways of being. I mean, it's such an ontological challenge as well in some ways. So, I mean, we can think more about this, I'm sure, but I'm not sure we have more time though. Yeah. At Shubhashree and others at PLD, I think if there are no further questions on Facebook, I don't see any here. It's time for a wrap up, and thank you so much. And Deepa, as always, it's very stimulating to be talking to you.
Yeah, thank you so much for doing it, really. Thank you so much for doing it.
Thanks, PLD, of course, for giving us a great opportunity.
Shubhashree, everyone.
Wanted to point out there have been questions about how to access these films by Deepa. So if you could just lay that out.
Yeah, perhaps you can just share Deepa's email address on the chat box, and whoever would like to watch the films can get in touch with her. That perhaps may be the best way. I mean, we could have listened to you both for a much longer time, but I would really personally like to, I'm very grateful for this conversation. Because for me personally, what I take away from this is, of course, the idea is about talking about Deepa's work and what is a feminist practice. But for me, the last 1.5 hours has actually been about Deepa's work and also in some ways a history making of the women's movement, right, in the past 40 years. And I think it has been very enriching because I feel that there's a way that many conversations around us in some places, we speak about the current moment wherein as if it's been created in a vacuum, and to actually see how individuals and collectives of women have over a period of time, the struggles they've had and the work they've done. And as you said, Geeta, with a sense of solidarity, with a sense of care, with a sense of labor. So that was really beautiful to hear. And also something, Deepa, you said in the end, which has struck a chord for me as a feminist, as a filmmaker myself, this act of listening and being in the moment. I don't think that's just about a film practice, right? As you're saying, it is the very bedrock of what we call feminism itself. It's a gaze and a way of looking at the world. So thank you both for actually shining a light on that and for getting us to reflect and think about it. So do write to Deepa if you would like to watch her films. The fourth part of the series next month will be photographer Sheba Chachi, who will be in conversation with Professor Sabina Gadiok. That should be in the last week of January. Do watch out. But thank you all, each and every one of you, for being there. Good night.